Take your Bibles tonight and find the fifth chapter of the Gospel of Mark. Mark chapter 5. I want to preach a sermon. I've been preaching a little bit this year and can't seem to put it down. I just believe somebody tonight may need this simple word. It never gets old with me. It's a miracle of Jesus. And the miracles of Jesus never get old to me. I'm preaching tonight on this subject. It's time to wake up. It's time to wake up. From the Gospel of Mark chapter 5, stand for the reading of the Word of God. Would you do that? Everybody standing? Mark's Gospel chapter 5. The Bible says, beginning in Mark chapter 5 verse 35, and the Bible says, while he yet spake, there came from the ruler of the synagogue's house certain which said, thy daughter's dead. Why troublest thou the master any further? As soon as Jesus heard the word that was spoken, he saith unto the ruler of the synagogue, be not afraid, only believe. And he suffered no man to follow him, save Peter and James and John, the brother of James. And he cometh to the house of the ruler of the synagogue, and seeth the tumult, and them that wept and wailed greatly. And when he was come in, he saith unto them, why make ye this ado and weep? The damsel is not dead, but sleepeth. And they laughed him to scorn. But when he had put them all out, he takes the father and the mother of the damsel, and them that were with him, and entered in where the damsel was lying. And he took the damsel, or the little girl, by the hand, and said unto her, Talitha kumi, which is being interpreted, damsel, I say unto thee, arise. And straightway the damsel arose and walked, for she was of the age of 12 years. And they were astonished with a great astonishment. And he charged them straightly that no man should know it, and he commanded that something should be given her to eat. The resurrection of a 12-year-old girl. She was dead, and then she was alive again. Only Jesus can do that. I'm preaching on this subject. It's time to wake up. It's time to wake up. Pray with me as you're being seated around the building. Would you do that? Let's pray together. Father, first of all, for those you have saved this week, we give you glory. God, thank you, Lord, for the precious young lady that was saved last night. The young man the night before. God, thank you, Lord, for the way you've moved this week in power. God, thank you, Lord, for this wonderful attendance again on this Tuesday night to gather and praise you and hear your word. And now, Father, I pray that you would loose me and let me go. Pray that you'd set me free to preach. Bind every devil and demon spirit. God, help me to preach with abandonment tonight. And God, I'll thank you, Lord, for what you're going to do in this place, and I'll praise you in Jesus' name. And all God's people said, amen. Jeremiah 18:32 says, the Lord our God is a great and mighty God. I love the story of the young woman who was bringing her fiancé home to her parents' house one night to meet her mom and dad for the first time. The dad got the young man over in his private study after shaking hands with him, after introducing himself, asked him a few questions. He said, bud, I want to ask you a question. Do you have a job? Young man said, no. He said, you got any goals in life? He said, no. Said, got any money saved? He said, no. Said, you got a place for my little girl to live? He said, no. And the daddy became a little bit agitated. He said, you mean to tell me you're going to marry my little girl and you don't have no job, you don't have no money, you don't have a place for her to live? He said, no, sir, but I'm not a bit worried. I believe in God. I believe God will miraculously provide. Well, he left. Later that night, his wife, his own wife, was talking to her husband. She said to the man, the daddy of the house, she said, well, how'd the interview go? He said, not good. He said, I want you to know that boy don't have a job. That boy don't have any goals. That boy don't have any place for my little girl to live. But I guess there's good news. He does believe in miracles. As a matter of fact, he thinks I'm God. Some of you will get that in a minute, all right? Now, folks, I'm telling you, that old boy believed in the wrong God, didn't he? He might have believed in miracles, but he didn't have the right God. Well, I'm going to tell y'all, I believe in miracles, and I believe in the right God. Son, I'm telling you, my God can do anything. There's no mountain too mighty for him to move. There's no storm too strong for him to stop. There's no obstacle too imposing for him to overcome. There's no demon too difficult for him to defeat. If you've got a God like that, shout amen. Amen. That means you've got a God that can do anything. And the reason I love this passage is because it shares about my mighty God, the God that can do anything. Now you know this story, but if you don't, I'm going to bring you up to speed. 3 miracles are found in 1 chapter, in the 5th chapter of the Gospel of Mark. There's the miracle of Jesus casting the demons out of a man. There's the miracle of a woman who was hemorrhaging inside. And there's this miracle of a girl that was raised from the dead. So let me take you to the streets of Jerusalem. Here we go. The last miracle is this one. It is the story of a dying daughter, a desperate dad, and a divine doctor. And the young man, the daddy's name was Jairus. Jairus was a ruler of the synagogue, a big deal, an important guy. And he was looking for somebody to heal his daughter because his daughter was dying, 12 years old. And he heard that Jesus was in the streets. And so Jairus went to find Dr. Jesus to make a house call. And Jesus said, I'll do it. While he was walking to heal the little girl, y'all know the story, a big crowd gathered around him. And the Bible said there was a woman that had been bleeding inside for 12 years. And she burst out of the crowd. She was dying. And she fell down and grabbed the bottom of the robe of Jesus. And instantly she was healed. But by the time Jesus made it to the house of the little girl, she was dead. One was healed, but one was dead. By the time Jesus got there, the delay had caused the death. And when Jesus walked in, everybody give a mental picture. The room is full of mourners. The obituary column has been written. The funeral has been planned. They're about ready to carry the little girl out. So Jesus was not only the doctor, he's the resurrection and the life. So you know what he did? He just canceled the funeral. He just called off the wake. He gave the little girl a wake-up call, and I love it, found in verse 41. And he took the damsel or the little girl by the hand, and he said in her, Talitha Kumai, which is being interpreted damsel. Talitha Kumai is Aramaic. Jesus spoke Aramaic. And you know what he's saying? I'm going to give you the paraphrase. Little girl, wake up. He gave her a divine wake-up call, and she woke up. Can I tell you why I'm preaching this tonight? Because I'm telling you, I preach from time to time to a lot of dead folk. I'm not implying you're dead tonight. You can be breathing and still be dead. And I preach, preacher, to some dead folk. And can I tell you, as I travel around the country, I want you to know it's time for the church to get a wake-up call. It's time to wake up. Son, it's time for America to wake up. We are headed for the judgment of God. It's time to wake up. It's time for some dying soul here tonight who's lost in sin and on the road to hell. It's time for you to wake up. It's time for some feeble Christian who's lost their faith tonight and is living like they're lost. It's time to wake up. And it's time for some church member that needs old-fashioned, sin-killing, demon-chasing, wind-blowing, fire-falling, Holy Ghost revival. It's time to wake up. Matter of fact, there are three kind of folk here tonight need a miracle. Three kind. Going to get good now. Don't miss this. First of all, let me tell you who needs a miracle. Number one, it's time for discouraged saints to wake up. I briefly talked on this Sunday night. Let me go a little further. It's time for discouraged saints to wake up. Do y'all reckon that Jairus might have been discouraged? Oh, come on, son. Put yourself in his sandals. Look at verse 35. The Bible says, while he yet spake, there came from the ruler of the synagogue's house, which said, your daughter's dead. Everybody get a picture. Here's hearing the worst news he can ever hear. By the time they get to the house, some sweat-soaked person runs outside, panting and gasping for air, and said, no need to bother. Don't bring Jesus in. Too late. She's dead. Now I'm not reading into the scripture, Brother Rob, but I'm going to tell you as a daddy, I understand it might have been easy for Jairus to be discouraged. Might have been easy for Jairus to think, man, if that woman had not stopped Jesus in the street, my daughter would be well. Might be easy to do that. Anybody here ever get discouraged? I got four granddaughters, and two of them live only an hour from us. Two of them live considerably further away. Two live an hour. They live in St. Augustine, Florida, an hour south of Jacksonville. Last year, I was home one night, and those two little girls and my daughter, my son-in-law, couldn't come. They came to Jacksonville to go out to eat with my wife and I. We were going out to eat, and the little one was 2 years old at the time, and the other one was 4 years old at the time. This was last year. And we got in the minivan. I drove the minivan. I don't own a minivan. My minivan days are over, but I drove their minivan because it had the video screens to show the movies that the little girls watch while they're driving down the road. Grandparents, what in the world did we ever do in the old days when we couldn't have an entertainment system in the car? Well, they're watching the videos. I'm driving down the road. It's my wife, myself, my two granddaughters and my daughter. And all of a sudden, I'm driving down the road and a juice cup comes flying past my ear and bounces off the dashboard. Now, folks, those juice cups are heavy. You understand? They'll maim and cripple. This juice cup comes by me, and it was thrown by the two-year-old. And when the two-year-old, her name's Angeli, when she threw it, her mother, my daughter, grabbed her little hand and popped it and said, "Why did you do that? You could have hurt Granddaddy." And when she popped her little hand, Angeli started screaming. And when she started screaming, the other one, the four-year-old, started yelling, "Shut up, I can't hear my movie, shut up." Now, folks, all at once, we're having a minivan meltdown, one kid screaming, one kid's crying. And how many grandparents know this? When you reach a certain age, you don't want noise anymore. I mean, you don't want to hear it anymore. Y'all understand me? And all of a sudden, I had the greatest urge to go home by myself, sit in my recliner and hold my wiener dog. I mean, all at once, it was just all breaking loose. Hey, y'all know why the two-year-old threw the juice cup? She ran out of juice. Now, folks, that'll preach right there. I mean, she just ran out of juice, so she hurled it, man. That'll preach. I know a lot of Christians like that, Josh. I know a lot of Christians, when they run out of juice, they pitch a fit. I know a lot of Christians, when their cup is empty, they sit down and cry. There's a lot of Christians, you know exactly what they're feeling because life has suddenly run out of juice. But I'm going to tell you the tragedy. There are some Christians, or some of you may be here tonight, you've run out of juice. But you don't sit and cry or pitch a fit. When some folks run out of juice, you know what they do? They slip into the dark hole of discouragement. See, there may be somebody here tonight going through discouragement. Can I encourage you? I'm not hammering you. Can I encourage you that it's time to wake up? And you don't have to live in discouragement. Let me tell you what discouragement will do. First of all, discouragement will confuse you. Let me show you what I'm talking about. Everybody look again at verse 35. "While he yet spake, there came from the ruler of the synagogue's house certain which said, 'Your daughter's dead.'" Now watch this will preach. "Why troublest thou the master any further?" You know what the word troublest means? To harass, to annoy. Kind of put it in modern day language, why are you bugging Jesus? Don't bother bugging Jesus. It won't do any good. Don't bug Jesus anymore. Anybody ever have anybody bug you? Now look at me like you know what I'm talking about. I used to pastor a church. Brother Rob, the first church I pastored two churches. Wonderful years. The first church I pastored, I was 20-something years old, maybe a little older than my son is right now. There was a woman in that church, and I believe that she was put there by the devil himself. There was a woman in that church that was sent there to do nothing but bug me. And I'm telling you, she did it every Sunday. And I'm not being unkind. I have time for people. But I want you to know, preacher, that woman knew my path from my office back here to the pulpit every Sunday. We started at 11 o'clock, and the devil put her right there at the door entering the church at 3 minutes till 11, and she said the same five words every Sunday. Every Sunday. I'm telling you, the whole time I pastored that church, every Sunday, the same five words. "Preacher, I've got a problem." I mean, every week, "Preacher, I got a problem." She had a problem with her husband. She had a problem with her kids. She had a problem with who set the thermostat in the building. She had a promise with her Bible, a problem with her Bible teacher every Sunday. So I'm going to be honest with y'all. It got discouraging. It's discouraging for a preacher to be met by somebody who's got a problem every week right before you go into the church to preach. So I started hiding from her. I really did. I would hide from her until church started. Isn't that cruel? I really did. And one Sunday, I'm in my 20s, man. I'm a grown man. I hid in the men's changing room, in the baptistry room, and I thought, surely she won't come in here. I'm here to tell you, it wouldn't have made no difference if I was in the men's restroom. I'm telling you, that woman at 1 minute till 11 come walking in and found me. And I'm sitting there trying to look spiritual, like I'm meditating. And you know what she said? She didn't say, "Preacher, I got a problem." She changed it that week. "Preacher, I'm glad I found you. I got a problem." I'm telling you, all that woman did was bug me. I don't look at me like you don't know what I mean. We've got people in our life that bug us. Can I give somebody a good word? Somebody needs to hear this statement tonight. You can't bug Jesus. I'm going to say that one more time. You can't bug Jesus. You can't overwhelm the Lord. You can't overload his plate. You can't burden out his schedule. Did somebody hear what I said? You can't bug Jesus. The one who holds the world in his hands can hold your problem. The world, the one who named the stars and numbers them, knows exactly what you're going through in your complex life. So I'm going to say it for the last time. You can't bug Jesus. And you know what discouragement will do? Discouragement will confuse you, because you know what the devil will tell you? The devil will tell you, don't take Jesus, that problem. It's too big for him. Go ahead and try to work it out yourself. Jesus can't handle that situation you're going through. Jesus doesn't understand what's happening in your life. And discouragement will confuse you. But I'm not finished. It'll not only confuse you. I'm going to be honest with you now. I've preached this sermon 6 or 7 times this year, and I'm going to get right in your grill right now, because I'm going to get right in mine. Not only will it confuse you, but it'll consume you. Discouragement will consume you. Let me show you what I'm talking about. Everybody look at the text. I'm going to get real now. I'm going to get real. Look what it says in verse 36. As soon as Jesus heard the word that was spoken, he saith unto the ruler of the synagogue, be not afraid. That literally means do not fret. Can I paraphrase? Don't worry. I'm going to say it one more time. Don't worry. And I'm preaching this now. First time I preached a sermon this year, I was in a state of Alaska. My wife Judy was with me, and she told me, sitting on the front row where Josh is sitting right now, she said, honey, if you listen to any sermon you preach this year, you better listen to this one. Because I have been a chronic worrier in my life. And I'm doing better. My son's here tonight. He may tell you I'm not everything I ought to be, but I'm better than I was. I'm trying to eliminate the word worry from my vocabulary. Because worry is an offense to a holy God. You know that, don't you? Oh, sure it is. Now, folks, I've worried my whole life. And when I was in my 20s, Rob, I used to stand in front of the mirror and worry that my hair was going to fall out. That worked out well, didn't it? I mean, worry. Preacher, when I was a young pastor and we'd have a low Sunday, I used to worry that our church was falling apart. Sometimes I've worried over the years when we don't have the proper numbers at our student camp to meet our budget and all that overhead and all we got. I mean, just worried about stuff. And we've heard all the stuff about worry, the statistics, but they're true. They're true. The University of Michigan did a study a few years ago about worry, and the experts on the panel found this out with a government grad. Here's what they said. 60% of everything we worry about is unwarranted. 20% of everything we worry about is out of our control. 18% of everything we worry about is trivial or inconsequential. 98%. That's what those three things total. 98% of everything we worry about, we can't change a bit with worry. I love the story of little Billy who was in the third grade. He was taking a fractions oral exam one day, and the teacher said, little Billy, what's 3/4 of 5/16? Billy said, I don't know, teacher, but it ain't enough to worry about. Now, folks, that's a cute little joke, but the truth is, worry's not a joke. Are you listening? If you don't listen to nothing else, get the next couple of minutes of the sermon. Worry's not a joke. I mean, you know what, Rob, we try to change the names of worry. We call it anxiety. We call it stress, and we call it tension. God's got another name for worry. Y'all know what it is? It's called sin. I said, I'm riding your grill because I'm riding my grill. He calls worry sin. Say, how do you know that, Rick? Because if there is an express command in the Word of God and we violate that command, it's sin. Let me give you the express command. Psalm 37:1, fret not thyself. That means do not worry. Let me give you another one. Philippians 4:6, be anxious or careful for nothing. But let me tell you exactly what Jesus said, and I'm not going to take time to turn to it. In the last 10 verses of the 6th chapter of the Gospel of Matthew, Jesus specifically talks about worry. And here's what my Lord said. He talks about the God who takes care of the birds in the air and the lilies in the field and the grass that grows. And here's what he says. How much more will he take care of you as children? And he uses it 4 times, Pastor, 4 times. Jesus used it 4 times. There's a phrase he used. You know what Jesus said? Take no thought. And you know what the phrase take no thought means? Do not worry. Now, folks, I'm not trying to split hairs and I'm not trying to hammer anybody, but I'm taking this in my own heart. You know what God's saying about worry? When we worry, it's an insult to the sovereignty of God. When we worry, it's a slap at the integrity of God. When we worry, it's a slap at the authority of God. When he says, do not worry, I'm going to take care of you. God says, do not worry. And when we worry, we're taking all that into ourselves. He says, do not worry. It means trust him. And you know why it's consuming? Because it covers us and it overwhelms us and it begins to break our bodies down when we worry. So if I don't say nothing else tonight, I've said enough. First of all, it's time for somebody who's living in discouragement, somebody who's overwhelmed with worry. It's time to stand against the enemy and wake up. God will take care of you. That little 4-year-old granddaughter was at my home last summer. Just her and I were outside. I don't know where everybody else was. and she slipped and skinned her knee on the pavers in our backyard. You know, Mama, that skin that takes the, that scrape that takes the skin off and it burns, and I blew on it and I kissed it and I rubbed it and I took her in my arms and carried her inside the air conditioner and I just held her and she was sobbing and sobbing, and finally she quit. Boy, she said something, one of my favorite moments of the year. She said something I'll never forget. I held that precious little baby girl, 4 years old, until she quit crying. And the sob became just a little whimper. And finally, she quit crying completely. And I just patted her little knee. And I said, baby girl, you about ready to get down? And boy, she said something to me. And I was so blessed. She said, no, granddaddy, hold me till it quits hurting. Aren't you glad you got a God that'll hold you till it quits hurting? I got news for you, son. He'll not only hold you when it quits hurting, he'll hold you all the way to the end. I'm telling you, somebody needs to get up out of the bed of discouragement. Well, I wanted to preach that to you tonight. Number two, it's time for somebody else to wake up. It's time for a discouraged saint to wake up. Number two, it's time for doubting spirits to wake up. Doubting spirits to wake up. Look what he says in verse 36. The Bible said, as soon as Jesus heard the word that was spoken, he said to the ruler of the synagogue, be not afraid, only what? Only what? Can I tell you what that means in the Greek? Keep on believing. Hey, I like this, Brother Rob. It comes from a word that means stand firm. That's what it means. Takes me back to my basketball days. Only had one year in basketball. I played baseball almost all my life, 12, 13 years. But I played varsity basketball 1 year. I was a sophomore. And I was the second team point guard behind a kid that was probably all county or close to it. He was really good. I don't remember if he met all county or not, but he was the best player on our team. And we were playing one night against the second ranked team in the state, Hillsborough High School from Tampa, Florida. And I never got to play much. And our coach constantly stressed fundamentals. You basketball guys, here's what he stressed. He would write on the chalkboard, stand firm. Long before I understood what stand firm meant biblically, stand firm. Y'all know what taking a charge is. If you don't know basketball, let me tell you what it is. If the other guy or girl's got the ball and they're trying to make it to the basket or they're advancing the ball, you stand in front of them with both feet planted. And if you do that in time and they run over you, it hurts, but your team gets the ball, and it's a charge. And so our coach, Coach Taylor Stokes was his name, he'd write on the blackboard, stand firm, take a charge. And preacher, I got in the game that night against Hillsborough High School. And I only got in the game because our point guard turned his ankle, and he's on the bench. And they put me in, and we're already hopelessly behind. And Hillsborough High School had a Division I prospect. This kid was 6'8", 220 pounds. Now, that's big now, but back then that was a moose, man. 6'8", 220 pounds. And I mean, that old boy had it all. And I'm passing the basketball, and their team intercepted, and they got it to the big guy, and he's coming down the court, and I'm the only one between him and the basket. So I went back. I kept backing up. And preacher, I'm standing right in the middle of the lane, and here he comes right here. And I knew what he was going to do. There's no way he's going to run around a 130-pound kid. He weighed 220 pounds. The guy's huge. At the time, I don't know, 5'6" or whatever. And he's coming right down the middle of the lane, son. And I knew he was going to jump over me if he could. And here he come. I mean, fear is racing through my body. I looked at that guy. He's right there. He's coming. And I'm telling you, I stood right there. Coach Stokes, in one ear, I hear his words, stand firm. And in the other ear, I heard, run like a scalded dog. Now, one was the words of Coach Stokes. The other was my words. Y'all, who do you think I listened to? I tell you what I did. I ran like a scalded dog. I ran to the back of the baseline. I had the best seat in the house. I watched that guy. Oh, it's pretty, man. I watched that guy jam that basketball with such force he nearly hit me when it came down. But I watched that whole thing, and it was amazing. Our coach called timeout, put me on the bench. And he put our other point guard back in. I believe he'd have put him back in if he only had 1 foot. He put him back in, and the next day, he made an example of me. Here's what he said. I'm not kidding. He said, now, guys, we saw last night how not to take a charge. And I really didn't think it was a big deal because we lost by like 40 points. But he said, we found out how not to take a charge. He said, now, you can either stand firm or you can run like Coram. That's exactly what he said. I'm not kidding. Now, that'll preach right there. That's a silly story. Matter of fact, sadly, some of you won't remember the whole sermon, but you'll remember that story. That's what's so sad. But can I tell you something? Long before God gave me this sermon, it's a magnificent picture of standing firm when trouble comes. Would you look at me a moment? If you're a child of God, you're going to have trouble. I don't give a rip what the joy boys say. I don't care what the prosperity preacher preaches. I don't care about the guy that tells you you're always going to get up on the right side of the bed, always going to have money in the bank, and never going to get sick. I'm telling you, trouble is going to come into the life of a child of God. And when trouble comes, you're either going to stand firm and trust the Lord in the midst of that difficulty, or you're going to run. So I want to ask you a couple of personal questions. Where do you run to when all hell breaks loose in your life? Where do you turn when a real emergency comes? Now, this is a very important point of this message. Maybe the most important point. Because we're saved and we live by faith. But I want you to understand, when your faith is weak and somebody's faith may be weak tonight, the devil is filling you with the disease of doubt. Why does the devil want you to doubt? Why does he want you to doubt your salvation? Why does he want you to doubt the goodness and provision of God? Why does he want you to doubt when trouble comes in your life? One simple reason. The devil knows if you and I believe our doubts, we'll soon doubt our beliefs. I'm going to say that one more time. He knows if we believe our doubts, we'll doubt our beliefs. So he gives us the disease of doubt. Now, I'm preaching this sermon because somebody needs this. Somebody needs to get up out of the bed of discouragement, but somebody needs to get up out of the bed of doubt. Let me tell you why the devil wants you to doubt. Two reasons, and this is good. Don't miss this. Two reasons. First of all, the devil wants you to doubt so you'll be blind to the presence of the Lord. Brother Rob, I'd never seen this before, but it is so practical. Look what it says in verse 38. The Bible says he cometh to the house of the ruler of the synagogue. Verse 39 is clearer than that. Verse 39 says, and when he was come in. I'm going to go ahead and say it. He's in the house. I'm going to say it one more time. He's in the house. He's in the house and they have no idea who's standing there. Are you kidding me? The resurrection and the life is in the house and they're planning a funeral. They're wringing their hands when they ought to be lifting their hands. He's in the house and they don't even realize who's there. And I'm going to tell you, because I love you, it can happen to some saint of God tonight. I'm telling you, you're in the house of the living God with the body of Christ in the presence of the Lord. I'll say it again. He's in the house. That's why it's important to come to church. And I know you're here on a Tuesday night, but that's why it's important to be together in the house of God. I talked to a brother about this on the phone this very day. Preacher, there was a time when young pastors and preachers would go to Bible conferences and go to places where they could experience the freshness of the Lord. And they don't do that as much anymore. And he was telling me about in their home state where he lives, how it was pitiful attendance at the State Evangelism Conference, though had some of the greatest preachers in America there. And you know what he told me? He said, because it's so easy for people to watch podcasts today and to stay home today and watch it on computer. But I'm going to say one more time what I said Sunday. They miss the joy of the gathering. There's something about the body life, about us being together in the house of God. That's why it's important to come to church. Listen, I love Brother Rob, I love Brother Josh, and I love you. But I didn't come to see you tonight. I came to be with you, but I came to see Jesus in the presence of the Lord. That's why it's important to go to church. So I'm going to tell you before I go to my next point, I'm going to throw this next part in for no charge. That's why you ought not miss church. By the way, if you're well on Sunday and you miss church and you could be in church, can I tell you what you're doing? You're casting a vote for the devil's crowd. You're casting a vote to close the doors of the church. I'm so tired and weary of a day when you got to beg Christians to come to church. I was in Alabama last year and they had a no excuse Sunday. And they had all, it was a hoot, it was for a high attendance day, but it was cool. They had signs all over the church, no excuses, no excuses. And this wasn't literal, but it was funny, Brother Rob. I memorized them. I thought this was hilarious. All over the building, no excuse. There was eight of them. Number one, they said, we're going to provide cots in the lobby for those who like to sleep in on Sunday. Number two, we're going to provide helmets for those who believe the roof will fall in if you come in the doors of the church. Number three, we're going to provide hearing aids if you think the preacher's too soft and cotton if you think he's way too loud. Number four, we're going to provide scorecards for those who like to list the hypocrites in the church. Number five, we're going to provide blankets for those who believe it's too cold in the building. And we're going to provide personal fans for those who believe it's too hot. Number six, we're going to provide folding chairs for those who believe you can only worship God outdoors. Number seven, we're going to have a meal after church for those who believe you can't cook for your family and come to church at the same time. And my favorite, Brother Rob, was number eight. Number eight, we're going to have poinsettias on this side of the church and lilies on this side of the church for those who've never seen the inside of the church, those two flowers in the building. But I'm going to share something with you. Please hear me because I love you. I tell you I love you, please hear me. I still believe there are thousands of people who go to stained glass window churches every Sunday, who listen to choirs sing like the angels of heaven, who hear preachers preach sermons that ring the bells of heaven, but they miss Jesus. You know why? Because they're so saturated with worry, and they're saturated with worldliness, and they're saturated with all the affairs of life that somehow they miss Jesus. So listen to me. Don't take it for granted. I don't care if you've been a Christian 50 years. I don't care if you know all the words and know all the songs. I don't care if you know all the miracles and you could quote this sermon yourself because you know this miracle. Never take it for granted. Always let it be fresh. Never miss the privilege to know that while we're here tonight, hallelujah, He's in the house. You're in the presence of the Lord God. And when you're walking in doubt, some of you can be so fretful that the devil will blind you to the presence of the Lord. And I'll tell you what else he'll do. Doubt will not only blind you to the presence of the Lord, it'll bind you to the power of the liar. Have you noticed very carefully verse 40? The Bible said they laughed him to scorn. He's in the house, but they laughed at him when he said, "This girl will get up." They laughed at him. He said, "She's only sleeping." He said, "Rick, I thought you said she was dead." She is dead, but death is sleep to a child of God. And he said, "She will get up again," but they're full of doubt. Preacher, everybody here may be saved tonight. But there may be somebody here that's lost. And I want you to understand something. Everybody in the world has faith in something. I'm going to say that one more time. Everybody has faith in something. Oh, come on, son. I mean, you got a man who's an atheist, goes to a doctor that he doesn't even know, who tells him he's got disease that he's never heard of, writes him a prescription that he can't read, about a medicine that he can't pronounce, goes to the pharmacist to have it filled, and he doesn't know the pharmacist, gets that medicine and he takes that medicine even though it's poison and he'll keep taking it, or even though it tastes like poison, and he'll keep taking it and he'll have it refilled. That's a degree of faith. Oh, come on, son. Tomorrow an atheist will get on a busy expressway having faith that his brakes will not fail. An agnostic will go under a surgeon's knife believing that the surgeon won't make a mistake. An infidel will drink water from a spigot believing that it doesn't have bacteria. Those things are kind of faith, but you better hold on, son. They're not the kind of faith that we've got. You understand? I'm telling you, that's a different kind of faith. That's not Bible faith. Because I'm telling you, that surgeon might make a mistake. And those brakes might fail. And that water might be poison. But can I stand right here tonight and tell you, my God, my Jehovah God, my Jehovah Jireh, my Jehovah Rapha, can I tell you, my God cannot lie, He cannot change, and He cannot fail. I have a faith in that God. And I'm telling you, Christian faith is different than a lost person's faith. Understand, we've got Bible faith. We see with our eyes, but our faith gives us vision. Understand, by faith, we walk by faith, child of God, not by sight. We don't have all the answers, but we've got faith in the one who does. We walk by faith. Understand what faith is for a child of God. Faith sees the invisible. Faith attempts the impossible. Faith hears the inaudible. Faith touches the intangible. I believe I'll run that by you again. Faith sees the invisible. It hears. It hears the inaudible. It attempts the impossible. It touches the intangible. Those things are faith. Are you kidding me? We've got a different kind of faith. We live by faith. I was not there the day this book was written, but by faith, Brother Rob, I believe every word. I was not there the day the blood flowed from Jesus' body down the cross and down the hill, but by faith, I've experienced its cleansing power. I was not there the stone was rolled away from the door, but by faith, I've experienced the resurrection life. Brother Rob and I a moment ago prayed to a God that I have never seen, who's building me a home in a place I've never been, and He's going to take me by a mode of transportation I've never traveled. And I want y'all to know, I believe it all because I've got faith in that mighty God. I'm talking about faith. And let me tell you about faith. Faith is what a child of God has. D.L. Moody says, a little bit of faith will take your soul to heaven, but a lot of faith will bring heaven to your soul. And I'm preaching this tonight because somebody's on the ropes. Somebody's wrestling with the Lord. Somebody's faith is in trouble tonight. Can I give you three quick words? It'll take me 30 seconds. When you think God's not listening, He is. When you think things are out of control, they're not. When you think He doesn't have a plan, He does. I believe I'll run that by you again. It might take a little more than 30 seconds. When you think God's not listening, He is. When you think things are out of control, they're not. When you think God doesn't have a plan, hallelujah, He does. An atheist married a woman of God. He said, I'll not keep you from church. I'll not keep you from your Jesus life, but I'm an atheist. He said, I promise you I won't never harass you about going to church, but when we have children, you could even take them to church, but I'm going to teach them atheism. She agreed. She was in love. They married and he treated her good. He was an atheist. He treated her good. He never stopped her from going to church. And then a little boy came along a few years after marriage. Little boy grew up to be a preschooler and then a first grader and began to read. Went to Sunday school with his mama every Sunday in church. And when came home after listening to those Bible teachers at that church school, and his daddy would always teach him about atheism. And his daddy put signs all over the house promoting atheism and the philosophy of atheism. And one week he kept his office and study door closed because he put something else on his wall. Had an artist come in who had a beautiful hand for script, and he put something on the walls, right at the top of the wall, right underneath the ceiling, all the way around the room, running in continuous letters that said, God is nowhere, God's nowhere, God is nowhere. And it was beautiful, though it was blasphemy. It was all over that, all over the inside of that office. That Sunday came and the dad couldn't hardly wait. His boy went to the church, heard his Bible teacher in the class talk about Jesus, heard the church preacher talk about God, came home and went into his father's study. That's where he went every Sunday. His daddy was in his chair in his study reading the comics and the Sunday paper. Boy came in and daddy said, what'd you learn today, boy? And the boy said, Daddy, I learned about God. Dad said, I want you to look here, son. Look what I had put up this week. Isn't that pretty? Little boy said, yeah. Look at that script that said, God is nowhere. God's nowhere. He said, well, you read good now, don't you, son? Tell me what that says. Little boy looked up, looked at it, went all the way around the room, turned his body, went all around the room. Daddy said, well, read it to me. What does it say? Little boy said, Daddy, it says God is now here. Can I give you a good word? He's now here. Can I put it like this? He's in the house. It's time for discouraged saints to wake up. It's time for doubting spirits to wake up. And there may be somebody here that needs this one. Number three, it's time for dying souls to wake up. Don't you miss the miracle. Did I tell you the girl's dead? She's dead. Look what happens very carefully in verse 41. And he took the damsel by the hand and said unto her, Talitha kumi, which is being interpreted, damsel, I say unto thee, arise. And straightway the damsel arose. Resurrection. This is a resurrection. Understand? The Bible said that Jesus walked in, took her by the hand, spoke to her, and she got up. I want everybody to make this real clear one more time. She was dead. And I'm not being crude. I'm not being ugly. But if you're here tonight and you're not saved, you're dead. That's not an insult. God said that. Paul said, you with he quickened who were dead in trespasses and sin. You're dead. Everybody that's saved tonight is not better than you. They were dead. Now they're alive. Listen to me. You might look at me and say, Rick, you don't understand. I'm in the best shape of my life. I got abs of steel. I can run a marathon. It don't make a difference. You're dead. You might have got the best doctor's report you ever got. Your blood pressure, your cholesterol might be at the all-time low levels, but I'm telling you, you're dead. I'm telling you, you might be the healthiest person in the room, but if you live long enough, one day it's still going to take six men to carry you out of this church. I'm telling you, we're all dead when we're lost. Our bodies will just catch up to that, and you will die eternally, spend eternity in the lake of fire. There are no degrees of death. It's not dead, dead or deadest. If you're dead, you're dead. And if you're alive, you're alive. And there's only one way to be alive. The preacher can't do it. The evangelist can't do it. The student minister can't do it. Nobody in the house can do it, but there's somebody in the house that can do it, son. He can raise you from the dead tonight. Everybody here that's saved had a resurrection. Everybody here who's saved had a miracle. Everybody here that's saved had a point in their life in which they were dead, but they were made alive in Christ. Two people have already had that happen to them this week. They had a moment where Dr. Jesus touched them, and now they're alive. And this little girl got up, and you know what I love about this, Brother Rob? Two of my favorite words in the New Testament are immediately and straightway. It means right now. It means there's no therapy, boys. It means you don't have to come back for all kind of appointments. It means when the doctor touches you, you are instantly well. And when the doctor saves you, you are instantly saved. It's time for dying souls to wake up. Our ministry has a student camp. We've had it now, I think, I don't know what year this will be, Jonathan. I think this will be 28, maybe. 27. I don't know, 7 or 8 years ago at our camp, maybe a little bit longer, the week we had our camp in Tennessee, we had a young man there, Brother Rob, whose name was Ryan. He was a big football player. He was from Avon Park, Florida, and he was there. And he was a tough guy, which meant, you know, he didn't participate in much of anything. He was just cool. Pastor and student minister rather told me he was having a hard time involving him in all the stuff and couldn't get Ryan to participate in all this stuff. But on Thursday night, that big tough stud football player walked down the aisle of that student camp, gave his life to Christ. He got saved. Student minister came to me the next day, said, I wish you'd have been in our student sharing time night and heard him speak. Said, this kid, only time he got up in front of people was when he got on the offensive line at his high school football field. Said, you should have heard him. He wouldn't shut up. Said he was so full of Jesus. All he was doing was testifying. And he wrote a letter. And he read the letter to the students. It was a beautiful letter. And I've got the letter. I've got a copy of the letter on a file in my office. Now, I don't have the actual letter. A copy was sent to me. He testified on Friday to his kids again and went home. They had a student service on Sunday night after the youth camp, and student minister told me how he testified there and how he just was so full of the Lord. On Monday morning, he got in his truck to go somewhere, and he was following another truck that was pulling a boat. And somehow that boat came unhooked and came back and came through the front of Ryan's truck, killed him instantly. Didn't even open the casket at the coffin. He was saved Thursday night. He testified Sunday night. He was dead Monday morning. The reason I know about the letter is because the student minister sent me a copy of the letter, preacher, to read at the next, we still had 1 week of camp left, to read to the next week of camp. And I read that letter and I told Ryan's story. You know what he put at the end of that letter after he testified to those students? You know what he put? Now my life is worth living. Now my life is worth living. He had 3 days to live it. Now he's living eternally with Jesus forever. 3 days. I don't know how many days you'll have to live it, but you can't live it until you get saved, until Jesus comes into your life.